Worship team's a little smaller this morning. I'm going to bring a little more intimate worship. So let's pray. Father, thank you for this place. Thank you for the privilege and the blessing of gathering in your Son Jesus' name, Lord. Thank you for worship. Thank you for music. God, we're grateful to come and sing to you. We pray that you would be honored, that as we lift up our voices, as we play our instruments, God, that you would be pleased. You'd hear these songs, God, and it would bring you joy. We bless you in Jesus' name. My firm foundation, the rock on which I stand, when everything around me is shaken, I've never been more glad. I put my faith in Jesus. He's never let me down. He's faithful through generations, so why would he fail now? He won't, he won't. I've still got joy in chaos. I've got peace that makes no sense. I won't be going under. Cause I build my life on Jesus. He's never let me down. He's faithful in every season. So why would he fail now?
That you never fail us. And let that be the reminder this morning when we walk through seasons of struggle or difficulty, when it feels like it's just hard to even catch our breaths because we're just so overwhelmed by what the world is throwing at us. Lord, you never fail us. You've never failed us. Your goodness goes beyond anything that we can comprehend. You are a good father. Your foundation is strong when we are weak. Father, just remind us of your goodness even in this moment. We thank you so much, Lord, that you never fail us. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.
Well, good morning, everyone. You guys can go ahead and take a quick seat. It's great to see you guys all here this morning, and those that are joining us online, it's great to have you as well. I'm Pam Carey, ministry coordinator here at the church.
And I'm Rasika Keeley, office manager and youth pastor here at the church.
So before we continue on in worship, we do have some announcements, some things that we want to tell you guys about. And I keep your ears open because we have something for every generation that we're going to talk about. And when we start talking about these events and these things that we have, we're going to say, hey, go to our website and sign up. And when I say that, I mean go to theradiantlife.church, click on events, and get signed up. It's kind of like this, you know, the same thing. We try to make it easy. So we're not going to repeat that every time, but that's where you go to sign up. If you don't really have access to the internet, you don't really like it or whatever, find us afterwards and we can help get you signed up as well. So if you get our newsletter, our weekly email newsletter, and if you don't, you can email info@theradiantlife.church to get signed up. But if you got that this week, you'll see that our summer life group signups are active. They're on our webpage. You can go to the website and you can see all of the life groups that are going to be offered this summer. And what's really cool about life groups is that if you're in a place where you're feeling like, man, I really need to get connected. I don't have community. I need people around me to help me grow in my walk with Jesus. Or I just need to make connections here at the church because as we get bigger, we have to get smaller, right? We have to get smaller in our communities and we have to support each other. Life groups are a great way to do that. And this summer, most of them are going to be message-based. So we're going to hear the message, then we're going to go to the homes or wherever we choose to meet. And we're going to talk about it. We're going to have questions and we're going to have things that we're going to talk about from the message. But there's going to be some topical ones as well. Like you may have seen before service started, there's one that Bethany and Jamie are doing called the Hope Group. And you can see what that's all about. So go to our website, check out all the life groups, different days, different times, get signed up, get plugged in.
Hey, Pam, you mentioned a way to get connected, and we do a service called First Wednesday, the first Wednesday of every month here at the church at 6 p.m., and I love First Wednesday so much. It's just a time to be intentional in prayer and worship, so 6 to 7, the first Wednesday of this month, we would love to see you here for First Wednesday.
And this is our last week talking about the next event, which is our Men's Stronger Conference. So men, we need you. We really need you to get signed up today if you're planning to come, because we need to order shirts. And if you want to make sure that you get your shirt size, get signed up today. If you're a small and all we have is a triple X by the time we're done, that's what you're getting. So if you don't get signed up today. But if you can't get signed up today for whatever reason, we understand that. We still want you to come. We still want you to sign up. You can even come at the door. But for planning purposes, we do appreciate a little heads up if you are going to join us. And it's going to be next Friday and Saturday, so May 5th and 6th. It's May 5th on Friday in the evening. And then on Saturday, you'll be done by about 1. So you're going to hear, it's a streamed conference like the IF Gathering, like the ladies have experienced. But it's going to be Craig Rochelle, Levi Lusco, some other great speakers. And then there's going to be food. There's going to be ribs, apparently from Yoder's, I think is what they said, yeah. And you'll get a shirt and a swag bag. So it's going to be a great time just to come hear some good speakers, hear what God wants to say to you, eat some good food, and connect with some other men. So that's next Friday and Saturday, May 5th and 6th.
Yes, we speak highly and a lot about two ministries here at the church. The first one is Next Steps, and that actually is going to be starting next Sunday, and that is during
Second
service. We did this backwards. Second service is Next Steps. I want to just tell you quickly that I took Next Steps a little bit later in the game than all of my other lovely coworkers, so I did get harassed quite often. But when I took Next Steps, I thought I knew a lot about the church or even about my own boss, Ryan, but I actually didn't. And it was so interesting and so cool to hear about the church and about Ryan's story, but also to learn my next steps, to learn my giftings and my shape, and to really make sure that I was being intentional about where I was serving, but also to point other people into next steps. So if you're interested in serving here at the church, and you're like, man, where do I start? We want to point you to Next Steps, because it's going to be such a valuable resource for you to learn what you need to learn in order to make sure that you get into that sweet spot with serving.
Yeah, and you know, I said this first service, and Rasika just hit on it. I have people that come to me, and they're like, man, I need to get connected here. Like, what do I need to do? What's the best thing to start with? And we always point to next steps. Go through next steps, meet some people, learn about the church, learn about your giftings, get plugged in. That's a great place to start. And you know, those that are joining us online, they do have an online option as well. Obviously, our preference is that you're here, you're physically here with people, but if you can't make it to the in-person experience, then there is an option to sign up online as well.
Yes, and then Discover Purpose is another amazing ministry that we have here at the church, and that takes place next Sunday as well, but that's going to be during first service. So see, we flip-flopped it just to keep you on your toes. But Discover Purpose is another resource that we use. If you're just wondering, hey, what is my purpose in life? I don't know if you've ever questioned that, or maybe you're just like, Lord, what am I supposed to be doing? This class is going to be so helpful for that. I actually said in first service, so I went out of town this last week for a work conference, and I'll tell you my age. I'm 26 years old, so I got to rent a car.
First time driving a rental car.
It was great, guys. It was great. Rocked out in that minivan, that's for sure. When I returned the rental car, I was so lost and so confused, and my GPS was telling me one thing, and then my passenger was telling me another thing, and I was just like, I am so confused. And so I think sometimes we can get really confused on what our purpose is. And so if you want to have some clarity, if you want some more information on what God is calling you to and how he wants to use you to build his kingdom, check out Discover Purpose.
And we've mentioned this next thing, child dedication. I think it was last week we mentioned it, maybe the week before. But here at Radiant Life Church, we have the water baptism. And we believe that you get baptized when you're able to understand and make that decision and understand really what that means to be baptized. So we have had kids that are baptized, you know, up through adults. But the littles, the toddlers and the babies that don't quite understand what baptism is, what we offer for the parents is an opportunity for child dedication. And so what that's saying is, as a parent, I am committing to raising my child to learn about and to know Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior, to experience the love of Jesus in their life as they're growing up. And I said earlier, you know, I have a 17 and an almost 15-year-old, and there's no guarantee what track our kids are going to take when they leave the house. But the best thing we can do is while they're with us is to teach them about Jesus and to point them that direction and hope that the seeds that we've planted when they are with us will you know, come to fruition and will bear good fruit when they're on their own and when they're adults. And so that's what child dedication is doing, is you're committing to raise your children in a home that loves Jesus and that talks about Jesus and teaches them about Jesus. So there's going to be two classes that Amy, our kids director, requires parents to attend before the child dedication. That's going to be Tuesday, May 9th and Tuesday, May 16th right here at the church. So again, get signed up. Check that out. If you have any questions, reach out to Amy or see one of us after service.
Hey, Pam, I love the word picture that you said of planting seeds, because this next announcement is about NTS, which is a camp that we get to attend at Marion, Indiana, at Indiana Wesleyan University in Marion, Indiana. And all I can say is seeds are planted at this camp. It is a week filled of Jesus and fun and stinky teenagers, but that's still a lot of fun. But the registration deadline is coming up. So that is May 8th. Can you guys say May 8th? Can you say it like you really are excited about it? May 8th? Okay, so students going into sixth grade all the way through students who have just graduated, you have until May 8th to register for NTS. We just want to make sure that we've got transportation covered and we give them all of the information that they need, so that way your student or students that are going will have a dorm, so that way they can, you know, have a bed to sleep on. But we also believe in this camp so much here at the church that if you as a parent or guardian are able to cover the $150 deposit fee, we as a church will cover the rest, which is actually more than the deposit. So we just want to make sure that kids have the access and the ability to go to this camp, because we know that it changes lives and it plants those seeds. So if you have any questions, feel free to find me after service or Pam. We'd love to talk to you about that. And we also know that sometimes finances are still just an issue. So if that's, you know, where you are, or where you are as a student, we again want to have that conversation, because we have scholarships available. We don't want finances to be the issue. Yep,
absolutely. And you know, you guys are a faithful church. You're a generous church. And we can do things like cover the cost or the majority of the cost for students to attend NTS camp because of your faithful giving. Last year we did this and we had 65 students. That's a lot of kids, first of all, to take. But we were able to cover the majority of this fee for 65 students. You guys, that's crazy insane. That's crazy generous. I think that's awesome. So thank you for putting God first with your finances, because when you do, He is faithful to provide for your needs. And there's several ways you can give. You can give online. You can go to our website. You can download the Tithely app, or you can give as you leave. The worship attendants will have baskets there that you can drop in your tithing or your offering. So thank you so much for that. Would you guys stand? Before we head into our next worship song, which is Jesus Have It All, we're going to do a responsive reading. And it's out of Psalm 62. And it's just talking about God is our rock and our salvation. We just sang Firm Foundation. Christ is my firm foundation. And when the wind blows, things can get tough. We might get blown around a little bit, but we're going to make it through. We're not going to get taken out, because He is the source of our joy. He's the source of our salvation. We can trust Him. He's the only constant thing in this world that we have to count on, is Jesus. So as we read this Psalm 62, just think about that. Think about how you can release things over to God. Things that we try to hold on to, things that we try to take control of, that we absolutely don't have control of. That's just a false thought that we have, because ultimately God is in control and we can trust Him. He is faithful and He is good and He loves us. So I'm going to read the white words. You guys are going to read the gold or yellow, whatever that looks like to you guys. I am at rest in God alone. My salvation comes from Him. He alone. Stronghold, I will never be shaken. How long will you threaten a man? Will all of you attack as if he were a leaning wall or a tottering fence? They only plan to bring him down from his high position. They take pleasure in lying. They bless with their mouths, but they curse inwardly. Rest in God alone, my soul, for my hope comes from Him. He alone is my rock and my salvation. my stronghold. I will not be shaken. My salvation and glory depend on God. My strong rock, my refuge is in God. Trust in Him at all times, you people. Pour out your hearts before Him. God is our refuge. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, just thank you. Thank you so much, Lord, that we don't have to try and figure everything out. We don't have to be in control. Lord, help us to experience the peace that comes when we realize that you are ultimately in control. And help us to open our hands and release everything over to you. As we sing this next song, Jesus, Have It All, Lord, help us to realize that our lives exist to bring glory and honor to you. Help us to release things over to you, to open our hands and allow you to take control of our lives. Let us live lives that bring you glory and honor, Lord. Just thank you and praise you in Jesus' name.
Jesus, have it all.
Jesus hide. I give it all. I give it all. I give it all to you.
I have life. what is true through Brandon as he delivers his teaching, and give us clarity of the mind and open hearts to receive what comes from Holy Spirit this morning. Would you help us to also take it into our life and put it into action after we leave here and all throughout the week? In your name we pray, amen.
Good morning. It's good to see you, church family. It's good to be here with you. If you're a guest, my name is Brandon. I'm one of the pastors here on staff, and we've been in a teaching series called Awaken, and we're going through the book of Acts, and it's basically after Jesus' resurrection and just really the birth of the church. And last, we're going to pick up where Pastor Josh left off last week in Acts chapter 6. And so we're going to cover a lot of ground here this morning. We're going to pick up in chapter 6 of Acts, and we're going to go through the entire chapter 7 of Acts. And the staff was asking, hey, how can we pray for you? And my prayer was, I'm going to go really fast, and I'm afraid that I'm going to lose some people. So if you're a note taker, don't get hung up on, you can always watch the recording, right? You can always go back, but don't get hung up on writing every little thing, or you can take a picture or something and go back to it. But we're going to go at a pretty sturdy pace today. Are you guys ready for that?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, it could blow our hair back. You want your hair blown back? Some of you are I'm still waking up. Keep the coffee coming. So we're all over the place when it comes to that, being ready and wanting to go fast. But I hope to keep you all together as we cover a ton of ground. So today's teaching is called Full Resisting in Full. And I think that will make more sense as we kind of cover all of this ground from Acts chapter 6 all the way through Acts 7. So we're going to pick up right where Pastor Josh left off. Remember, there was the laying of the hands, the apostles were trying to help out with the Hellenistic Jews who kind of felt like they were being left out. There was a laying of hands, and they were looking for someone to wait tables. But it was actually a really high standard for waiting tables, right? You need to be full of the Spirit, and you need to have wisdom. And so there's a lot of gravity to that. And then we're given a list of names, and we're going to hear about this guy, Stephen, and we're going to pick back up with Stephen. So Acts chapter 6, starting at verse 8. Now Stephen, full of grace and power, was performing great wonders and signs among the people. All right, we got to pause. We got a ton of ground to cover, but there's a couple of key things that we need to pick up here. Luke gives us a major detail here, right? And we already knew this, that Stephen, he is full of grace and power. So the question is, what are you full of? Now, maybe you've been told what you're full of, but what are you full of? So let me rephrase the question. Let's look at it a little bit differently. Do people want to be around you? Are you so full of God's presence and His Holy Spirit that you are so full of compassion and gentleness and joy that people want to be around you? So what are you full of? And do people want to be around you because you are filled with the presence of God? All right, let's continue. It says that Stephen did wonders and signs. And I think this is awesome, right? I would imagine there was some healing. People were released from torment. And I think it's easy to look at signs and wonders as stained glass. It's this beautiful thing that we can look at and admire, but I don't think that's how God intended it. I think it's more supposed to be clear glass. Yes, we can see the signs and wonders, but do we see through the signs and wonders to the creator of the signs and wonders? Are you tracking with me? It has nothing to do with Stephen and the signs and wonders. It's about the indwelling of the Holy Spirit in his life. And the signs and wonders, we should be able to see through those to see the creator of the universe. All right, let's continue. All right, Opposition arose, however, from some of the members of the Freedmen Synagogue. All right, let's pause for a second. How many people know that there's Bible encyclopedias? That's okay, a few of you. That's awesome. Like, I was kind of assuming most people didn't. Like, we're gonna nerd out for just like 2 seconds here. You can go Google search Bible encyclopedias. I'm gonna grab an expert on this. The Baker Encyclopedia says members of the Jewish synagogue in Jerusalem in Acts 9 are descendants from Jews who had been captured and taken to Rome by the general Pompey in 106 to 48. I love this. Check this out. Pompey found that the Jews adhered so strictly to their religious and national customs that they were worthless as slaves. Like, they were so stuck to their Bible, what we would call the Older Testament in our Bible. They were so stuck to the customs of Moses that they were worthless as slaves. Now, keep that in the back of your mind as we continue in the narrative. All right, so they're the Freedom Synagogue composed of both Cyrenians and Alexandrians and some from Sicily. All right, now we have to nerd out on this as well. If you were to fast forward in the book of Acts, Acts chapter 21, verse 39, let's find out who's from this area. It's this guy named Paul. Paul said, I'm a Jewish man from Tarsus of Cilicia. So we know, as we read further in Acts, that Paul is from this area. So Luke puts this detail in there. So we get about this Freedom Synagogue, and they're just so stuck and rigid in their customs and their traditions. But we also see that there's a group of people, and Paul, which we're going to see play out in Acts 7, we're going to see that he was there as well. Let's continue with the narrative. Then they secretly persuaded some men to say, we heard him speaking blasphemous words against Moses and God, against Moses and God. They stirred up the people, the elders and the scribes. So they came, seized him, and took him to the Sanhedrin. Now, 2 weeks ago, Pastor Ryan introduced this image. This is an image of what the Sanhedrin would look like. So Stephen would be standing right in the middle of the Sanhedrin in this place. And then they continue with their allegations. For we heard him say that this Jesus of Nazareth will destroy this place. They're talking about the temple. They're just accusing him that, oh, they're gonna destroy the temple, even Jesus. I mean, we could go back in the Gospels and see him quoting this and change the customs that Moses handed down. So they're worried about this location, this place, and they're worried about traditions that come from Moses. And all who were sitting in the Sanhedrin looked intently at him and saw that his face was like the face of an angel. I find this fascinating. I think there's a ton of allusions. You know, they're talking about how they're messing up, how Stephen is messing up the traditions of Moses. But this reminds me of a story about Moses. Check this out in Exodus 34. It says, as Moses descended from the Mount Sinai with the two tablets of the testimony, the Ten Commandments, in his hands, as he descended the mountain, he did not realize that his skin of his face shone as a result of speaking with the Lord. When Aaron and all the Israelites saw Moses, the skin of his face shone. They were afraid to come near him. Interesting. I wonder where else I've heard this. Gospel of Mark and Jesus and the transfiguration. After 6 days, Jesus took Peter, James, and John and led them up on a mountain by themselves to be alone. He was transfigured in front of them. And his clothes became dazzling, extremely white, as no launder on earth could whiten them. Not even the best Clorox bleach could make these as white as what Jesus was in that moment. And I just find that absolutely fascinating that we see all of these allusions, things that God has used. And so really to kind of sum up all these accusations, they were blaming Stephen of blasphemy of God. They were saying, hey, he wants to destroy the temple, or this Jesus of Nazareth, he wants to destroy the temple. And man, he is jacking up the traditions of Moses. And then you flip the page or you look a little bit further down and there's Acts chapter 7. Now, we're not gonna cover the entire teaching that Stephen does. Three quarters of this chapter is Stephen doing a teaching. Kind of, you know, you've accused me of these things. Let me tell you what the actual truth is. And man, it almost can look like a history lesson if you kind of look at it. Like he'll mention Abraham. So in Genesis chapter 12, that's where God made a covenant and a promise with Abraham. And from Abraham are all the descendants. Like the lineage of the Jewish people all goes back to Abraham in this covenant that God made with him. And he just lays this all out. Like he talks about how the temple wasn't just in one location. You can't box God into this tent. It's always moving. And so he was trying to explain this, help them understand their scriptures. Now, the commentary, the Message on Acts, written by John Stott, he kind of sums it up this way. He says, what he did was not just to rehearse the salient features of the Old Testament story with which the Sanhedrin were as familiar as he, but to do so in such a way as to draw lessons from it, which they had never heard or even noticed. His concern was to demonstrate that his position, far from being blasphemous because disrespected God's word, he actually honored it. John continues, he says, for Old Testament scripture itself confirmed his teaching about the temple and the law, and especially the predicting of the Messiah, whereas by rejecting him, it was they who disregarded the law, not he. Stephen's mind had evidently soaked up the Old Testament, for his speech is like a patchwork of allusion to it. I find that fascinating. I love that language that he used. But here's a challenge for us, friends. Like, do we spend so much time in God's word, like where we're soaking it up? And then when we have conversations with people, is there allusions to what we have read in God's word? Like, when you're at the coffee shop or at a restaurant or whatever, like, is there allusions in your conversations that you have with other people? Have we soaked so much in this that we can't help but to overflow what we've had? And that's exactly what Stephen did. He took their scriptures and he actually presented them the way that they were supposed to be presented. It wasn't about a temple. Like, if God's temple was destroyed, that doesn't mean that God's presence is destroyed. It's everywhere. The curtain was torn. God was going around with a pillar of fire and a cloud. Like, God wasn't limited, and they had put God into a box. And then he goes through this whole teaching. He tries to help them understand their scriptures, and then he drops the bomb here. He says, you stiff-necked people with uncircumcised hearts and ears, you have always resisted the Holy Spirit as your ancestors did, you also. Ugh. Like, I feel uncomfortable reading those words. Like, there is a ton of truth. You know, and we talk a lot about the Holy Spirit here at Radiant Life. In fact, last week, like there was a laying of hands that happened here and inviting the presence of God, the Holy Spirit, commissioning you. But man, like, here's a question to wrestle with. Like, are you resisting Holy Spirit still? Are you resisting Holy Spirit? Stephen continues. He says, which of the prophets did your ancestors not persecute? They even killed those who foretold the coming of the righteous one, whose betrayers and murderers you have now become. You received the law under the direction of angels, and yet you have not kept it. Oh man, like he is bringing a really hard truth. And now we see what their response is. When they heard these things, they were enraged and gnashed their teeth at him. I have no idea what gnashing of teeth looks like. But Stephen, full of what? Full of the Holy Spirit, gazed into heaven, and he saw the glory of God and Jesus standing at the right hand of God. I don't know what this scene looked like. I don't know if it's like God just like rolled back the curtains of heaven and he just had this glimpse, or if he was daydreaming. I don't know what this looked like. But he got to see a glimpse into heaven. And what I find interesting that Luke puts this little detail in there is that Jesus is standing. Most of the time when we see in the scripture, we read that Jesus is sitting next to the Father. But in this particular instance, he's standing. And I wonder, this is just my holy imagination, that Stephen is standing before this religious elite. And he's confessing and he's teaching, he's proclaiming the name of Jesus. And I'm wondering if Jesus is standing on behalf of Stephen and saying that to the Father. Just an interesting detail that I kind of was pondering. And then the religious elite, they yelled at the top of their voices and covered their ears and together rushed against him. They dragged him out of the city and began to stone him. And the witnesses laid their garments at the feet of the young man named Saul. So they weren't even they weren't even willing to listen. They're like, ah, la, 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 like we're not going to hear what you have to say. And they dragged him out of the city because in Roman law at the time, who's in control, they would not allow capital punishment to happen. So really, this is a scene of a lynching on Stephen. They're literally dragging him out. This was against even the Roman law for them to go out. And they laid their garments at the feet of the young man named Saul. Now, if you are to read ahead in the narrative, we learn that Saul has a crazy encounter with Jesus. And then from there on out, he's called Paul. So Paul and people from his region were here at this moment while Stephen was being stoned. And while they were stoning Stephen, he called out, Lord Jesus, receive my spirit. And I find this fascinating. The same author that wrote this in the book of Acts also wrote one of our gospels, Luke, and he penned these words of Jesus when he was nailed on the cross. And Jesus called out with a loud voice, Father, into your hands I entrust my spirit. And saying this, he breathed his last. The parallels are just so obvious when you see them and you begin to intake God's word. And while they were still stoning Stephen, he called out, Lord Jesus, receive my spirit. He knelt down. He cried out with a loud voice, Lord, do not hold this sin against them. And after saying this, he fell asleep. And I think that's Luke's way of kind of making this a PG version. There was nothing glamorous. There was nothing neat and tidy about Stephen being stoned. They were literally throwing rocks at him until he died. And while this is happening, he says, hey, don't hold this sin against them. And we're going to talk about that here in a minute. So now that we've covered all of this narrative, how do we actually make this practical in our life? Like, how do we allow transformation to happen? So if you're a note taker, I'm gonna give you 4 B's that we get from Stephen. These are 4 practical things that we can do based on Stephen's life and the narrative. The first is be a servant. Be a servant. Like if you were to go back to Acts 6, right? It was all about the serving of the tables. You need to be filled with the Spirit. There needs to be a level of wisdom. And Stephen is mentioned in that list. We know that Stephen was a servant. He had a servant's heart. Even Jesus talked about this. Mark chapter 10, verse 45. For even the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve and to give his life as a ransom for many. So Jesus, he talked about this. I mean, you can spend a significant amount of time in looking at the scriptures and it talks about our heart and how we need to be servants. But I love how a lot of our newer Testament letters open up. So Paul wrote to the church in Rome. He says, Paul, a servant of Christ. Then you have James, the half-brother Jesus. He says, James, a servant of God and of the Lord Jesus Christ. Peter, one of the closest followers of Jesus, says, a servant and an apostle of Jesus Christ. Then we have Jude, a servant of Jesus Christ and the brother of James. Service is all throughout Scripture. So the question for us to wrestle with here today is, how can I be a servant where I live, work, and play? Husbands, how can you be a servant in your household? We don't have wives and children to serve us. How can we model this idea of service within the household? What does it look like to serve at work? Not have the attitude of, I deserve this much. What happens when we have that shift in our mind where we realize that we're there to serve the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords who provided the job to begin with? How do we go into our workplace with the mindset that I'm here to serve other people here today? And what does this look like where you play? I mean, for me, I love to play disc golf. We have a beautiful course at Cade Lake, but what does it look like out on the course and maybe there's a piece of trash that's on the ground, you can pick up the piece of trash and throw it in the trash can. Full transparency, honestly, like this is raw. Like the flesh of me like wants to make a big deal out of that. Hey, look at me, I picked up this piece of trash. I'm really helping out everybody here at the course. Like, that's my attitude. That's the flesh that I wrestle with. I don't know if you wrestle with those things, but do we have that service mindset? How do we be a servant? All right, the second B, be a witness. Or maybe a couple other ways to say that is be a storyteller. How can you begin to share your story? I mean, Stephen, we just read, like, he was a witness. He went through the Sanhedrin scriptures, and God just shined his light through the Holy Spirit, through Stephen, and he was a witness even to the Sanhedrin. But one of my favorite examples of this is in the Gospel of John. And in John chapter 4, there's this awesome story about the Samaritan woman at the well. John chapter 4. Verse 27, it says, just then his disciples arrived and they were amazed that he was talking with a woman. Yet no one said, what do you want? Or why are you talking with her? Then the woman left her water jar, went into the town and told the people, come see a man who told me everything I ever did. Could this be the Messiah? And they left the town and made their way to him. Now we don't have time to unpack this whole story, but we'll just say this woman had a reputation. Like when she says, hey, come see the man that told everything about me. And they were like, hey, we saw your social media. We saw what you did on spring break. Like that is cray cray. You probably shouldn't have posted that. Like that's not good. Like people knew who she was. Please hear this. You are not defined by your story. God wants to redeem your story. It didn't matter what her past was or what her spring break was. God used that. Come, see the man. And what did they do? They left the town and made their way to him. It didn't matter what her life was before Jesus. What mattered now was Jesus and moving forward. We need to wrestle with that, friends. It doesn't matter what your past is, what bad decisions you've made, all the regret that you're carrying, all of those things don't matter. What matters is you now with Jesus and moving forward, amen? You are not defined by your past. You are defined by the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. I love this. Revelation 12:11. They conquered him, the devil, by the blood of the Lamb, who's Jesus, and by the word of their testimony, their story. What does it look like for us? Oh man, I hope that you catch this. We can be a witness. We can share our story. We can give our testimony. However you want to massage that, we can talk about Jesus. And it's about Jesus and how he's redeemed our story. It doesn't matter whether your testimony was sex, drugs, and rock and roll, or you grew up in the church and you were a good kid. God can use all of it. So how can we be a witness where we live, work, and play? You know, since surrendering my life over to Jesus, there has not been one work environment where I have not witnessed or shared my story or given a testimony about Jesus. Single mom, or not, well, single moms and stay-at-home moms. Like, you're being a witness to your children. What about in the workplace? I want to press in just a little bit right here. I just want to challenge just a little bit. Are you scared to talk about Jesus in your workplace? I mean, I worked for Sturgis Public Schools. That did not prevent me from talking about Jesus with my coworkers. That did not prevent me from praying with some coworkers. God provided the job anyways. If I was going to get fired for sharing my faith, I would consider that great joy. But God's going to provide the next opportunity and the next job for me. How can we be a witness where we work, live, and play? How can we be a witness? How can you share your story? How can you give a testimony where you work, live, and play? Now, the third B, and this could be maybe the most challenging one, is be a forgiving disciple. Be a forgiving follower of Jesus. I mean, go back to the narrative that we just read. Do not hold this sin against them. He's literally saying that as they're throwing stones and killing him. He's saying that. And we could take a whole hour just talking about forgiveness. And I'm just trying to introduce this concept. I'm just trying to give space for Holy Spirit to do something in your heart and your mind. Pastor, teacher, author, John Mark Comer, he talks about this idea of forgiveness. He says, the question isn't, how do you get through life without being hurt? Not gonna happen. The question is, when you are hurt, how do you deal with it? Forgiveness is not just releasing the right to pay back who has hurt you. It's also absorbing the pain with God's help. You know, God forgives as far as the east is from the west. And if you sit and think about that, that's a really far, that's far away. But for us humans, we can't just forget. I think that whole forgive and forget thing, I think that's a myth. But what does it look like, not in our own strength, not in our own will, to begin to absorb some of this hurt? I think John Mark Comer hit it. With God's help, I would argue with Christian counseling, in biblical community, these are places that we can begin to process that hurt. Because if we don't transform it, we're going to transmit it. We're just going to transmit it. I'll give you an example from my own life where the Lord just really did a number on me. I was one of the pastors at a church, and I basically got fired from that church. Now, they would probably say they didn't fire me, and what they did was they offered me an unpaid volunteer position. So call it potato, potato, however you want to look at that situation. But I had a ton of anger going on inside of it. It's like someone just pulled the rug out from underneath me. And I had so much anger and bitterness towards my pastor. I was so disappointed that he didn't stand up and fight for me in that moment. And I had all this bitterness and this rage and this anger. And the I don't know about you guys, but for me, when I'm angry and when I'm upset and bitter, I actually take it on the people I love the most. My wife and my kids, they get the brunt of it. And they had nothing to do with it. And so I transmit all of this stuff, and it's always on to the people I love the most. And so through Christian counseling and Holy Spirit, I was encouraged, and I'm just gonna get, this is a real practical way. I'm not saying like maybe this is a thing that you can use when it comes to forgiving someone. But for me, I had to write a letter. And I think the beauty about writing a letter is you can erase it, you can retype it, you can redo it, where with words, once they're out, they're out. You can't put toothpaste back into the tube, right? And so I was able to rewrite that, and I was able to really work on specifically what was upsetting to me and how I was hurt. And I put it in an envelope, I addressed it, and I stamped it. But Holy Spirit did something inside of me, really deep into my heart. And it wasn't like an audible voice, but it was kind of like, hey, if you mail this, like you need to let go of some stuff. And so I sat on that envelope for like 6 months. Because I knew when I put it in the mailbox, like there needed to be a release, and I wasn't ready to release it. I was still harboring a lot of that inside of me. And then finally, Holy Spirit, he just kept doing what he does. I had people that were speaking life into me. And finally, I dropped it in one of those blue mailboxes. I kid you not. It was like a couple weeks later, the Lord tested me in that. A student that we were ministering to, who we just absolutely loved dearly, her father passed away unexpectedly. And my wife and I were just deeply convicted to go love on her and her mom. And we wanted to go to that funeral. But I knew that my former pastor was going to be there. So it's almost like, oh, you dropped that in there? You said you let that go? Okay, let's test it. Now, I'm not saying that God caused my friend's dad to die, but God uses circumstances like that. He can use the death of a loved one to minister to you. That's what God does. He turns stuff upside down all the time. So I go to the funeral, and I went in there fully expected. Like, in my heart, I was ready to hug him. Because the things that I had said, like, I hope that God uses you. I hope that the ministry flourishes. Like, I genuinely wanted those things to happen in my former pastor's life. And I was prepared to give him a hug and to embrace him. And I thought, for me, like, that hug, like, that was gonna be the thing. That was gonna be like this standing stone in this moment that represented that God stepped into this situation. And he did show up. Now, I can't report that we talked or hugged or anything like that. But I was prepared in my heart of hearts for that moment. So I share that story as an example. Maybe a lot of us are playing this thing in our head right now that we were hurt. And I'm not trying to minimize that pain and that hurt in your life. Please hear me on that. I'm not minimizing it. But how do we begin to transform that? How do we begin to respond to it instead of react to it every time that memory comes back? Now, Paul, who we know was at this stoning of Stephen, and as we read further, has this encounter with Jesus, radically changes his life, and he plants churches all over the place, wrote a large portion of our Newer Testament. He understood the importance of forgiveness. And he wrote to the church in Ephesus, and we find this in Ephesians chapter 4, verse 30 through 32. And don't grieve God's Holy Spirit. You were sealed by him for the day of redemption. I mean, we're talking about being filled with the Spirit. I think it's a whole nother thing to grieve the Holy Spirit. So I would encourage you as much as possible, stay away from grieving the Holy Spirit. Paul's very practical. He says, let all bitterness, anger, wrath, shouting, and slander be removed from you, along with all malice. What are you transmitting? What needs to be transformed in your life when it comes to forgiveness? Because the flip side is, be kind, be compassionate to one another, forgiving one another, just as God also forgave you in Christ. I think it's easy to look at the circumstance that we're in where we've been wronged, we've been hurt. Once again, I'm not trying to minimize that. But what if we were to pull the lens back? And what if we were to look on our own life at the forgiveness that we've received? That malintent that you had in your mind towards that other person. The evil things that you actually thought. The things that you thought about while you were driving down the road for that other person. Did God forgive you in those moments? Because he can see right into the heart. And I think when we begin to kind of pull that lens back and we realize how much God has forgiven us, I think that makes it just a little bit easier, just a tad easier to forgive other people. So, question, what is your next step in forgiveness? We could spend a whole hour talking about this, but I just want to introduce this concept. Because Stephen, he modeled that. He's literally doing it while they were murdering him. All right, the final and fourth B. Be a hopeful person. Be a hopeful disciple. Be a hopeful apprentice of Jesus. We have the greatest message ever spoken. Amen? We have hope in the eternity to come. That when we take our last breath, that's not it. We can spend eternity with the creator of the universe. Check this out in Psalm 33, starting at verse 17. The horse is a false hope for safety. It provides no escape by its great power. But look, the Lord keeps his eye on those who fear him, those who depend on his faithful love. Pause. Last week, I told you to Google search Hesed. Everybody say Hesed. Here it is again. Like I'm telling you, Google search, what does the Bible mean when it comes to Hesed? H-E-S-E-D, Hesed. I'm telling you, there's so much depth to it. It said, those who depend on his Hesed love to rescue them from death and to keep them alive in the famine. We can try to put all the safety measures out. We can try to have all these world things, and that is a false hope, right? Like, we can collect as many guns as possible, but in the end, it's not gonna really matter. Now, if there was a zombie apocalypse, I do have some friends that have a lot of guns. I probably would try to go to their house in that event. But do we put, don't miss this with the joke, right? Like, don't miss this. Do we have a false hope in these worldly things that are around us? Like, do we accumulate? Do we collect? Do we have all of these things? And ultimately, it is just a false hope. When you take your last breath, that thing isn't gonna matter anymore. The psalmist continues, for we what with the Lord? We wait. We wait for the Lord. I hate waiting. Man, I hate waiting. We ordered food last night. We did one of those where like you can order ahead, then you go park in the spot and they bring the food out to you sort of thing. And then my daughter came home because she was at some friend's house and I didn't order any food for her. And so I said, hey, I'll get you some Taco Bell because she loves Taco Bell. And so I'm driving to go pick up my food and I pull into Taco Bell and there's literally four cars in the line. I'm like, seriously, I do not wanna wait. So I pull all the way around, I go pick up my food. I'm like, those cars will be through and I come back. And so I'm turning left into Taco Bell and I saw there was no one in the drive-thru line. I kid you not, four cars pulled in right in front of me trying to go into Taco Bell. I'm not making that up at all. Like, it's like, all right, Lord, I see that you're trying to work on some stuff in me. A lot more sanding that needs to happen in this area of my life. I hate waiting for the Lord. But we wait for the Lord. He is our help and shield, for our hearts rejoice in him because we trust in his holy name. May your faithful love rest on us, Lord, for we put our hope into you. Man, one of my favorite verses, I want to encourage you to put this one to memory. Romans 15, 13 says, now may the God of hope, fill you with all joy and peace as you believe so that you may overflow with hope by the power of the Holy Spirit. There's a call to action here. We find our hope from God, but through the power of the Holy Spirit, we overflow that hope to others. I was blessed to literally stand in this spot yesterday doing a funeral. And it was someone who was part of the church a really long time ago. And some of her children came up, adult children came up and started just sharing. And man, did they bring hope. And they brought hope through the power of the Holy Spirit. and what God has done in this lady's life and how that impacted all the people that were sitting in these chairs, this person's life, because of the Holy Spirit that was in their life. We can overflow hope by the power of the Holy Spirit to a lost, hurt, broken, busted up world that's out there. Now, John, one of the closest followers of Jesus, he got this crazy glimpse into heaven, and he wrote this in the book of Revelation. He says, "Then I heard a loud voice from the throne. Look, God's dwelling is with humanity, and he will live with them. They will be his people, and God himself will be with them and will be their God. I cannot wait for this moment. He will wipe away every tear from their eyes. Death will be no more. Grief, crying, and pain will be no more because the previous things have passed away." Who's ready to see that? Amen. Check this out. Then the one seated, not standing, on the throne said, "Look, I am making everything new." He also said, "Write, because these words are faithful and true." Jesus is coming back, friends, and he's going to make everything new, and our hope is found in that. So where can you bring hope? Where can you bring hope? I mean, the cliche would be, where can you bring where you live, work, and play? But how can we be a servant? How can we be a witness, be a people of forgiving, and just be hopeful wherever we're at? Worship team, you can make your way up. You can kill the house lights for a moment, please. So I just want to pause here for a few moments. Maybe grab the note-taking app out on your phone, or if you've been writing. But what is Holy Spirit saying to you? Like, maybe even write that out. Holy Spirit, what are you saying to me? Was there a song lyric? Was there a Bible verse that was said? Lord willing, through his power, there's something I said. That God is speaking to you. And looking at this example of Stephen, he was full of Holy Spirit. There was people who were resistant against that. But man, he was full of service. He was full of witness, story sharing. Like, Stephen was full. And I think that's the question that we all need to wrestle with, right? Stephen was just an ordinary dude like me, like you. He just put himself in a position to be obedient to Holy Spirit. And depending on what Holy Spirit is speaking to you, no pun intended here, but I think Holy Spirit wants to awaken something inside of you. I think when we're full of the Holy Spirit and we're obedient to the promptings of the Holy Spirit, if we try to mimic our life like the examples played out in the scripture, I think it's going to begin to awaken something incredible in our life. Now, I want you to catch this vision. Imagine just this room. I'm not even counting all of our friends and family online. Thank you for joining us. But just this room, just this space, not even the previous service. Imagine if we were a people full of the Holy Spirit, obedient to his promptings. This awakening that would begin to happen inside of us. Imagine how that would impact our community. If we were to live these things out where we live, work, and play, this would be this overflow through the power of the Holy Spirit. People wouldn't see a stained glass life. They would look through it and see the creator of the universe living inside of you. Try to grab that vision. So what is Holy Spirit saying to you? Write the thought down. Don't ignore this moment. What is Holy Spirit saying to you? God wants to do something incredible in and through your life. And he wants to use you in other people's lives. Would you stand with me? Oh, Jesus, I pray that the words that were spoken and ultimately your holy word, I just pray that you would minister to each one of us. Holy Spirit, meet us exactly where we're at in these moments. And maybe there's some freedom and healing that needs to happen. But Jesus, I just pray that you would just send your spirit and your glory into this space, in this moment in time, and would you speak to each one of us. Minister to us. Your servants are here, and your servants are willing. Speak to us. In Jesus' name, amen. Prayer partners, would you come down to the corners? The band's gonna sing us through part of a song here, and if you need prayer for anything, please come see the prayer partners. But may we just continue to have a heart and a posture that's completely surrendered over to Jesus.
Everything that we have over to you, Lord. We give you our hearts. We want to hear your voice. Help us to live lives that are surrendered and obedient to you and the calling that you have on us, Lord. Help us to be hope to somebody else by the way that your love shines through us. Help people to look into our lives, as Pastor Brandon said, and see you working in us. And Holy Spirit, would you fill us? Would you overflow us so that wherever we go, people would encounter you? Let us not leave here only hearing words and not being transformed, but transform our hearts, transform our lives to be a glorious reflection of you. In Jesus' name, amen. Our prayer team is gonna stick around after service, so if you need prayer, please come on down. They would be honored to lift you up in prayer. And don't leave yet. We've got one more thing here. Also, for those that are visiting with us this morning, we're so glad that you came to join us. We love having new faces. We love our church family that's been coming for years or for a couple weeks. We just love seeing you all here. But if you're a visitor with us this morning, would you stop at the green guest central desk in the lobby? We have a gift bag. We just want to say thanks for joining us. We're going to close out a little differently than we normally do. Some of you may have grown up singing this. We're going to sing the doxology before we head out.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above. God.